It's my pleasure to introduce Adam Bradley, who is our host tonight. Adam is a professor of English up at the University of Colorado at Boulder. He has some of his fans and students in the audience tonight. Yeah. I think there's more of you than that. You're just being shy. He directs the Laboratory for Race and Popular Culture, otherwise known as the Rap Lab. He is the author or editor of numerous books, including The Book of Rhymes, which is the poetry of pop, the anthology of rap, and the New York Times bestseller, One Day It'll All Make Sense, which is a memoir he wrote for the rapper and actor Common, someone you may have all heard of. Adam writes for a few small little time papers like the New York Times, the Los Angeles Times, the Washington Post, genius.com, and other venues. This fall, he will be releasing the Smithsonian Anthology of Hip Hop and Rap, which is a collection he helped curate alongside Chuck D, MC Light, Ninth Wonder, and Questlove. So please join me in welcoming Adam to the stage.
Are we ready for Rakim? That's what I like to hear. You know, I had a real long intro I was gonna do, fuck that. We gotta keep it fairly brief. But I will say this, because I know we have some hip-hop heads out there, and we hip-hop heads love to argue. We like our top five, dead or alive. Some fool even had a list of 50 circulating last year. Who has a 49th favorite MC? Well, these lists, you know what they do? They say something about the artist, but they mostly say something about us, how we want to represent ourselves to the world, our taste, who we want to be. And you know, for the longest time, I was a little bit shady with how I did my list because I was concerned that I had the right balance, some old school, some golden age, maybe a new artist so I didn't seem like a prisoner to the past. And you know, then get some diversity in there, gender, nationality, region, the South got something to say. You know, you gotta balance it out. And that's why I'm pissed off at Rakim. Because for 35 years, he's meant that basically we have a list of four. If you're out here in the streets with a list that doesn't have Rakim on it, what are you doing? Rakim is undisputed. There is no argument. He is one of the greatest, maybe the greatest person ever to pick up one of these, and also one of the greatest poets that we've seen in the 20th and 21st centuries. You gotta take it from me, I'm an English professor. This is the only time I've ever said something useful in my life. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming to the stage the God MC, Rakim.
Appreciate it. How everybody doing tonight, y'all? Right? Thanks for coming out. As you know, I got a book called Sweat the Technique. So we figured it'll make sense if we start with this record right here. We gonna do a little joints and a little talking. And I hope y'all enjoy the format. If y'all love hip hop, make some noise. One hand in the air like this for me. Cheer. Cheer. Okay, let's go. Cheer. Cheer. I call it, don't sweat the technique. Denver, Colorado. Say ho!
Don't sweat the technique.
Get in my bag. Thanks for coming out. We're gonna have a little fun. Check it out. Yo. Let's trace the hits. Check the foul. Let's see who bit. Dissect the style. I flip the script so they can't get foul. At least not now. It'll take a while. I change the pace to complete the beat. I drop the bass to them seats get weak. Every word they trace is a scar they keep. When I speak, it freaks, sweat, technique. I made my debut, 86, with a melody in the president's mix. Now I stay on target and refuse to miss. And I still make hits with beats, parties, clubs, and for cars and jeeps. My underground sound vibrates the streets. MCs want a beef, then I play for keys. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Denver, Colorado. Name of that book called Sweat the Technique. And y'all know what it is, you know. I'm a modest dude, but you know, I know when somebody biting my style, so that record right there was, you know what I mean, a little sarcastic song for Rakim. So without further ado, man, you wanna get it started? Let's do it, all right. Thank you. Peace and love, my brothers.
Yes, hold up.
Wow.
So, Rob, you got in 4 a.m. How you feel?
A little tired. Pretty good, though, man. This energy right here get me up and popping.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
You know what
yes,
I mean? Sir. Well.
Now, you talked about hip-hop as being rhythm and poetry, that's what rap is, that definition. And we just heard it on that song. What motivated you to structure your rhymes and the way that you did on that song? I mean, that was the thing that stands out when you hear you spit those bars.
I think the track, I think just like the feel of that, you know, that jazz bass line and the way the drums is rocking. I like to feed off the music, you know, and kind of create the style and also, you know, the direction, man. So I blame a lot of the music for my styles. Yeah, you know what I mean?
How does your playing saxophone and having so much music in your home, I mean, your family, musicians, your brothers and sisters, musicians, how did that influence the way that you approached the mic?
A lot, man. Like, coming up, my oldest brother, Ronnie, he went to college, you know, learned music. He went on tour with Mighty Sparrow, Calypso Band, Curtis Blow, you know what I mean? So coming up as a kid, and you know, my brother, you know, under him, he played saxophone, and I used to, whatever he did, I tried to do what he did, you know what I mean? My older brother loved him to death. But both my sisters sang. Mother, she sang everything from jazz to opera. So coming up, hearing that, I felt like I was supposed to be good at music. Everybody in the crib is good at music. I was like, I'm supposed to know how to do something, man. I didn't know what it was, so, you know, I tasked on what my brother was doing. My oldest brother played piano. That's too many fingers to kind of switch your whole mind, you know, 10 different ways. But saxophone was, to me, you know, I kind of, you know, liked the sax. It was kind of, you know, cool, and you know, I felt, you know, it'll be cool if I could play it. You know what I mean? But, you know, just fell in love with music and just pushed by, you know, how much they loved it as well.
In your book, you talk about Coltrane as an influence, and you say basically one of the things you lived by was, what would Coltrane do?
Yes, sir. What would Coltrane do? You know what I mean? And yeah, man, John Coltrane, he you know, he inspired me crazily, man. I remember listening to My Favorite Things, and I just remember, like, once he finished with the melody, he never repeated the same melody twice. So that was my thing, like, yo, I'ma never repeat the bar, you know what I mean? Once I start, I'ma, every time they hear another bar, it's gonna be different, you know what I mean? So, you know, I got that from Coltrane, you know what I mean? And tried to flow, you know, the way he played his solos and his melodies, man. So, you know, grew up off of that, and, you know, kinda, you know, like, just loved the influence that I had from jazz, man. It kind of gave me a different understanding of time and space. You know, understanding jazz, it's, you know, the timing is real complicated. So whenever I sat down to do hip hop, it was just 1, 2, 3, 4. I'm used to ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-
just took advantage of what I knew and implemented it in hip hop.
Coltrane used to talk about how he needed to know the words to the song before he could play his solos. And it seems like you're basically meeting him in the middle. You got the music in your mind and you're putting the words to it.
And that just seems such a perfect way of connecting it to jazz. One of your other influences with that was sports. I mean, you weren't too shabby on the gridiron.
Yeah,
Speak on how that shaped it.
Big sports fan, man. You know, this could have went a lot different. If I was a little taller, I would have been a quarterback, man. I swear, boy. I could have sworn I was going to be in the NFL, man. So, and what was funny, I was on my way to college, and I said, all right, I'm going to make me a tape. It's funny, it was cassette tapes back then. Well, I said, I'm going to make me a tape, and when I get in college, if somebody start beefing, I'm just going to put my tape in and shit back. I ain't got it. You know what I mean? I'm here for school, man. I'm trying to get education, man.
Yeah.
Put my tape in and shit back. So I made this tape, and man, you know, sometime, excuse me? That's a good question.
But you got to buy the book to find that out. You better buy that book.
Well, it's in the book. But yeah, you know what I mean? Like 80s, you know.
Yeah.
Whoa. But, yeah, man. And, you know, I had the tape ready. I was doing my thing, working out, trying to get ready, you know, for football season. I definitely had a spot on the college team. I was ready to go do my thing. And then one of my friends knocked on the door with Eric B. Yeah. I mean, and the rest was history, man. So, you know, luckily, you know what I mean? You know, things happened the way they did, man. Because again, man, quarterbacks nowadays, 6'7", 260 pounds, about 5'8", buck 30 myself. You know what I mean? So, you know, things happen for a reason, man. I had to, you know, take advantage of what it was. Word up, word up.
Maybe we can think a little bit about that Eric B's president joint a little bit.
Hold up.
You want to reminisce on that a little bit? Let's do that.
Could we do it officially? You want to throw that on for me first?
DJ Lazy Eyes.
Make a clap to this. To show our appreciation for your support.
1986.
Make a clap to this.
Thank officially. You. We was doing a wop off this right here. 1986. I'm going to need your help. Put your hands in the air like this right here. Colorado, we can say yeah, say hell yeah. Yo, I came in the door, said it before. I never let the mic magnetize me no more. But it's biting me, frightening me, inviting me to rhyme. I can't hold it back. I'm looking for the line. Taking off my coat, clearing my throat. The rhyme will be kicking in till I hit my last note. My mind remains defined, all kind of ideas. Self-esteem make it seem like the thought took years to build. Still say a rhyme after the next one. Prepared, never scared, I'll just bless one. And you know that I'm the soloist. Colorado gon' clap to this. To my people over here,
clap to this.
To my people over there,
clap to this.
To my people right here,
clap to
back
this.
There, over there,
they
up there, everywhere.
This.
Yo, I don't bug out or chill, won't be acting ill. No tricks since 86, it's time to build. Be easy on the cut, no mistakes allowed. Cuss to me, MC, me move the crowd. I made it easy to dance, it is. But can you detect what's coming next from the flex of the wrist? Indeed, you're not received, cause my man made a mix. Every bleeding won't need no mandate fix. Fingertips, throwing rhyme until there's no rhymes left. Hurry up, close the cuddle, make him bleed to death. But he's kicking it, cause it ain't no half-stepping. Party is live, the rhyme can't be kept it. Side of me's erupted just like a volcano. It ain't the A-Day style or the same old rhyme. I'm better than the rest of them. Eric B ain't on a cut, but my name is Rakim.
Make a clap to this. Make a clap to this.
Yeah, I always wanted to sit down and rhyme and shit, you know what I mean?
Make a clap to this.
To my lady, check it out. Go get a girl, get soft and warm. Don't get excited, you've been invited. But now it's out of hand, cause you told me you hate me. And then you asked, what have I done lately? First you said, all you want is love and affection. Let me be your angel when I'll be your protection. Take you out by your all kinds of things. I must have got you too high, burnt off your wings. You caught an attitude, you need food to eat up. Scheming like I'm dreaming on the couch with my feet up. Scream, I'm lazy, you must be crazy. Thought I was a donut?
Make a clap to this.
Yeah,
make a
clap. Colorado,
this.
Yeah. 1986. You know what I mean? I always wanted to sit down and rhyme, man. You know that. That's like that Frank Sinatra, Dean Martin, Sammy Davis, you know what I mean?
We could be in a Cadillac
all these little drink in my hand, you know what I mean? We substitute the cigarette for. But yeah, man, let's finish the.
Yeah.
So I'm going to take you to where you took us. Let's think about the summer of 86.
86, yes.
And you said that you essentially rhymed from 10 a.m. to midnight all that summer, writing and rhyming.
Yeah,
what
man,
was that just, like? What was going on there?
Just, you know, just say word. I'll be chill. Yeah. All right. good luck. But yeah, man, just, you know, this the love for hip hop and started to kind of catch on to something, you know what I mean? So it was like, you know, a tug of war thing, you know, wanting to play football, but, you know, I still had love for music, you know what I mean? So it was something, you know, that I was used to doing. But it, like I said, it got to the point, you know, I felt I was on to something. So like every day, whenever I had a chance, I'd get up and, you know, start writing. A lot of inspiration around that time, you know what I mean? And just, you know, I guess a part of my life or the time of my life, man, where, you know, the brain was moving at, you know, a million miles an hour, man. And that was one of my ways of, you know, just slowing down the universe and putting everything in perspective.
Now, with Eric B. getting in the mix, how did that change your trajectory toward actually putting some stuff on wax?
Well, once I met Eric B. and, you know, he told me, well, I played him that tape when he came to the crib. And, come on, man. What are you trying to make me show my age, man? Come on, man. It's like 85. Like 85, word up. I met Eric B. and the 85, word up. And I played that tape for him that I had made for college. And he was like, yo, I know Mr. Magic, Allah bless. Mr. Magic was a big radio disc jock back in the 80s in New York. And he was like, you know, I know Marley Marl. So, you know, little kid, hold up. So, you know, a little kid, I was a big Marley Marl fan, you know, big WBLS fan, Mr. Magic. And if you're gonna know anybody at that time, those are the dudes to know. So, you know, I was still a little, you know, torn, because I wanted to play football. And he was, you know, saying, you know, we can make this record. So I told him, I said, well, you know, I'm trying to go to college, man. I don't know if, you know what I mean, that's, you know, in the writings for me. But he was like, yo, we can do it where you're a guest to the record and you don't have to sign a contract. That's why the first single in 1985, which was 86, came out in 86,
yeah? Yes, sir. Yeah.
You know, it was Eric B. featuring Rakim. And, you know, featuring meaning is just a guest to a record. You don't really have to sign no contract. So, you know, I sat there, I said, well, so I can make a record and go play football. So to me, that was like a you know, no lose situation. So a couple weeks later, you know, I told him, you know, let's do it. And maybe 3 weeks later, he came back to the crib. He's like, yo, let's go to Marley Marl crib. I'm like, well, let's do it. Jumped on the train to Marley crib, Queensbridge, you know what I mean? And, you know, I'm here in Colorado tonight. Hold on. All right? 35, 30-something years later, you know?
So you're in Queensbridge, home of Nas, home of Mobb Deep, I mean, home just historic hip-hop.
Yes, sir, yes, sir.
Lineage in Queens. Yeah, and
bridge is open.
Yeah, that's right.
Nah, bridge is popping, don't get it twisted, right?
And you start spitting for Marley Marl. How did he respond at first?
Well, it was kind of funny, man. It, you know, sitting there, you know, I was 17, but I was, you know, I was stuck in my ways at that point. You know what I mean? I wasn't a knucklehead or you know, ignorant or none of that, but just I kind of knew what I was doing, especially when it came to me and my rhymes. But, you know, I got up in the joint. We already had the beat planned out. We just had to program the beat. So Marley, you know, he's best at that time. So Marley started programming the beat. We telling him, yo, put the, you know, drums like this. We want the bass line coming in like this. We want bang, bang, bang. Molly did everything, laid it down. So then it's my turn. So, you know, the way Molly's studio was, it was just like a little studio in his house. So he had a couch, and then I was comfortable like a month. By this time, I done watched him do the whole beat. You know, a couple hours went by, I done slouching the couch, I'm sitting there. So, you know, he's like, yo, all right, you know, let's do the rhymes. So he handed me the mic. I sat there just like this. Beat came on. I came in the door, shut it. So I was just watching Marley Marl while I was rhyming. You know, he was nodding his head. So, you know, after I finished, he was like, yo, you know, that was, you know, all right, but could you stand up and, you know, could you stand up so, you know, give it a little more energy? I looked at him, I was like, yo, you know, I said, I could stand up, but it's going to sound the same way. I can stand on the couch if you want, but that's the way it's gonna sound. I wrote it like that, man. You know what I mean? So, you know, he listened a couple times, and he still wanted me to put a little more energy, because at that time, people wasn't, you know, rhyming, you know, monotone, laid back like that. So, you know, finished the song, he listened to it, he was like, yo, it's a good song, but it still need to be a little, looking at him. So, we gotta finish the song, he go out, and bring MC Shan in. So Marley goes to the store, so I figured he gonna get Shan on me. So Marley goes to the store, Shan is, you know, engineering now. So I do the first verse, Shan stopped the track. Yo, Lord, yo, why don't you stand up, put a little bit. You know what I mean? I'm like, yo, Shan, man, me and Marley just went through this, man. That's all I got, man. I could you know, do some jumping jacks, you know what I mean, some push-ups. It's still gonna sound the same way. If you go back and listen to every tape I did, every tape, it was, you know, the same tone, same energy, you know what I mean? But I was trying to do that, you know what I mean? And luckily, I was, you know, kind of stuck in my ways, man, and I felt that, you know, that was the best style for me, and stuck to my guns, man. Hold up. Yo, a funny story. After the record came out, we did a show with Shan, Marley, Juice Crew, and all that. So I get out the car, I see Marley and Shan standing by the door. So I walk over to the joint. I pop my head up just as I get to him. You know, I have my head down. Like when you're in New York, somebody walk towards you with the joint there. People stand, you know, they real quiet, like, yo, what the fuck? Know that. So I walk up on them like this, get up on them, pull it down, pop up. They're like, oh, yeah, yo. But Marley was like, yo, G, I get it. I get it now. You know what I mean? So I looked at him, I was like, you get it? He was like, yeah, G, I get it, man. Marley, and then Shane was like, yeah, Ra. You know what I mean? The song is dope. You know what I mean? So again, man, I'm glad I stuck to my guns, man, because, hold up.
So you came in that second wave of hip hop after some folks had already laid the blueprint. You know, Melly Mel, Kaz, you know, cats like that.
Yeah,
you know.
Favorite dudes too.
Yeah, yeah.
Melly Mel, Kaz, and Mo D. Hold up.
So that evolution, how did you approach at once using the influence that those cats gave to you, but also pushing the art forward? I mean, you already talked about your more laid back approach rather than the kind of, you know, clap your hands, everybody, and that kind of flow, you know. Like, so
uh-oh,
what else?
Uh-oh.
I just rapped in front of Rakim.
Hold up.
So what, beyond just that more laid-back approach to how you rode the beat, what else did you consciously bring into to your style to differentiate yourself from what came before and what was around you at the moment that you were writing?
I think, I don't know, I think, you gonna help me out? Yeah, I think, like, as the game was, you know, evolving to where it was going, I tried to just, you know, take advantage of that. I always believed that music imitate life. You know what I mean? Not the other way around. So whatever, you know, I seen in the street or whatever I felt was, you know, a problem, one of the big problems in the neighborhood, or, you know, I just felt like that was my thing, you know what I mean? Concentrate on that and always just try to inspire, you know, the listeners to, you know, be whatever they wanted to be better, you know what I mean? Just, you know, I just felt like, I guess coming up, listening to that good R&B, you know what I mean? Stevie Wonder, you know, Gladys Knight, Marvin Gaye, you know what I mean? And they just always had a message, and it seemed like they seen the world and was able to, you know, put it on paper and let us see it in a different light. So I guess coming up, man, in that light, man, I felt that that was the way it was supposed to be done. Word up.
Shall we give him another little taste of something? What do you feel? What do you feel?
Word up. All right, I'm going to get up this time. I'm going to get up. Yeah. 1980-something. Yo, it's been a long time. I shouldn't have left you without a strong rhyme to step to. Think of how many weeks you just slept through. Time's up. I'm sorry I kept you. Thinking of this, you keep repeating your miss. The rhymes from the microphone solo whistle. You sit by the radio, hand on the dial stone as you hear it. Dance with the speaker till your head blow. Then plug in the headphone, cause here it go. It's the flow of the word when it's heard to control your body to dance. So, thou text the temple like a red alert. Reaches your reflex and let it work. Cause when this is playing, you can't get stuck with a step, so cassette number still come up with. A gift to be swift, follow the leader, the rhyme ago. Death for the record that was mixed a long time ago. It could be done, but only I could do it. For those that could dance, I start to think. Then I sink into the paper like I was ink. When I'm writing, I'm trapped in between the line. I escape when I finish the rhyme. I got. Now if you're not a record girl, I need to hear it right here, y'all. What up? What? 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 I know you got. Hey, hey, hey. One more verse, one more verse. Keep it rocking. I tell them, picture of my stage is empty. A beat like this might tempt me. The pole show my rings and my fat gold chain. Grab the mic like I'm on Soul Train, but I wait. Cause I mastered it. Let the others go first so the brothers don't miss. Eric B. break the sticks. Rakim will begin when you make the mix. I experiment like a scientist. You want to rhyme, you got to sign my list. Cause I'm a manifest. Blessed if I got hold, you want it next. Cause if you ain't got it, I'ma make an encore. Take the mic, make the people respond for the all. That's the way it have to be. If you want to get on after me, think about it. Wait, erase your rhyme. Forget it. Don't waste your time. Cause I'll be in the crowd if you ain't controlling it. Drop the mic. This is how it should be done. This style is identical to none. Some try to make it sound like this, but you're getting me. So upset that I'm wet cause you're sweating me. I drip steam like a microphone fiend. Ego to MC is my theme. I get hype when I hear drum roll. Rakim is on the mic. And you know I got... Yeah. Chip. Thank you, Colorado. Chip. That's 80 something, bro. That's 80 something, bro. 80 something.
80 something, man. Yeah. So, yo, yeah.
I got them Fendi Timberland joints on.
Fresh to death, man.
Got a little Fendi joints on there, man.
New York in the
house. We raffling these off. We gonna raffle these off after the joint, huh?
Man, so we hear James Brown in there. I know James Brown is a big influence on you and your art.
Yes, sir, big time.
Yeah,
big time.
Yeah. And that you were instrumental often in finding some of those beats, some of those samples to shape that music and your style and.
James Brown, man, is an incredible artist, man. Sometimes I sit and listen to his music. James came with a whole new sound, a whole new different style. He had a whole different ideology on how music should go. That's why it sounded just so different. And when I listen to him, me being an artist, when I listen to, you know, artists, even when I watch movies, I can't watch a movie without dissecting it and already going to the end. You know what I mean? So, but I look at James like instead of sometimes just listening to the music, I sit there and think what he was thinking when he made it. You know what I mean? What he was going through. You know what I mean? Maybe something in his life, maybe, you know what I mean? Or, but instead of just, you know, enjoying the music sometimes, I try to envision the journey. You know what I mean? So just kind of listening to James Brown, man, you know, to this day, you know what I mean? He blow me away, man. That's my man. And the rhyme on the James Brown track was just the ultimate feeling for MC back then. You know what I mean? So big up to James Brown, definitely.
Speaking about being an MC, your book that you just dropped is basically a blueprint for how to approach all creative arts, not just rapping, but you know, any endeavor that you might do. And I wonder if you could speak a little bit about your motivation for writing that kind of book, because it's not a traditional memoir, y'all. It's not just I was born and, you know, and now I'm sitting on stage in Denver, Colorado, you know.
Hold up. Yeah.
You know, we're doing that, thank God.
Yeah.
But you weave in so many lessons, so many, it's like a master class for people who want to think about art. So could you maybe break down one of the principles that motive that you kind of get into in the book?
Yeah, man, the thing about me doing a book, people been asking me for a while, you know, you should do a book. You know, I don't know, you know, I'm a modest cat. I always thought, like, you know, I'm not interesting enough to do a book, man. You know what I mean? What you like doing, Ra? Chilling. What brings you joy? Chilling. What was one of the best things you could remember? Chilling. So I always said, you know what I mean? It wouldn't work. You know what I mean? So I figured out, you know, through the years, man, because I always been kind of, you know, to myself with my personal life and my music. You know what I mean? So I figured this was a good way to get a little more in touch with my audience and speak about some of the things that I don't speak about when I'm on the mic or on stage. You know what I mean? But one of the ways I felt that'll make it a little more interesting, man, I felt if I can inspire the reader, you know what I mean, then it'll be entertaining. You know what I mean? And that's, you know, that was the goal, to just, you know, put some information in there. So it's not so much about, you know, me growing up or me going to the studio. It's more about the thought process, you know, how I think, why I make music, why I write like I do, some of the things that influence me in life and, you know, even some of the things that I can't understand, you know what I mean? But I try to put it in a book where, that's what I'm saying, man. Come on, give us a little feedback, baby. So, man, I thought y'all was, where the drinks at, man? Everybody a drink
got
on
some
me,
Henny. We got some Henny back in the green room, man.
Yeah, man. I just, you know, I felt if I can make the book inspiring, man, it'll be, you know, entertaining and interesting, man. So the book is, I think trying to figure out how life works and, you know, being informal with it, you know what I mean? I sit and think a lot, no matter what it is, if it's, you know, quantum physics or just a problem in the neighborhood, I try to figure it out, put it on paper where it still sounds good, but when you listen to it, you can get something from it, and you know what I mean? So just being, you know, in tune and conscious of what's going on around me is why I write like I do.
Yes, yes, yes.
Good question.
Now, one of the great features we have tonight is that phone number up there. and you can send us all your questions.
Hold up.
We're going to get them in the flow. You know, we kind of having church in here, it seems like. So right. So that's good. So
church.
Amen. let's see.
Duck down.
720-551-8352, 720-551-8352.
Nah, I don't think so. I don't think so.
Just but add on in, right? Just make it organic,
but man. But
add on.
But let's let's pick up on one of the things that you said, and actually just said to the answer to that wonderful question, which is about, you know, the way that you actually go about writing and particularly connecting out into the world. Your guy Chuck D once talked about, you know, basically hip hop being a kind of CNN for us.
Yes, sir.
And in a song like Ghetto, you know, you use that as an opportunity to look across the country, even across the world, really, and to see what unifies us, who are those of us who are close to the street. So maybe we could think a little about that song, maybe even hear a little bit if you feel it.
Well, word up, the ghetto had a personal, I guess, bond with me. My pops passed in 1988. I threw the year out there, so you ain't gotta ask. 1988, man, my pop passed away, and you know, that was my superhero, man, and I was kind of young at the time, about 18, and I didn't want to do nothing, man. I didn't want to rap. I didn't want to hear rap. I didn't want to go nowhere. Nothing, you know what I mean? You know, I was a young kid. I loved smoking weed. I didn't even want to smoke weed. This shit was like, that's when I knew something was wrong. It was like, so I didn't want to do nothing, man. Canceled a couple tours. I was supposed to go to Africa. I canceled that. You know what I mean? Long story short, people kept telling me it was his brother trying to get in touch with me. He had some beats for me. And at the time, I kept ignoring it because, you know, like I said, I didn't want to hear nothing. I played two records for like 2 weeks till my father passed away, man. It was Bob James, Nautilus, yes, and Miles Davis, which is Brew. Hold up. That's the only two records that fit the mood I was in, you know what I mean? But finally, man, so, you know, destiny, man, brought us together. I ran into this brother's wife, and she was like, yo, my husband's the producer that I've been trying to get at you. So she gave me the number, and that's when you kind of take things serious when somebody's wife run up on you. So I had to take the number, you know what I mean? She's like, yo, I'm like, all right, maybe this was supposed to happen, man. So I called my man up, spoke to him. He said he had some beats for me. He lived out in Queens. So I drove to Queens, man, and long story short, when I heard this beat that he played me, that's when I was like, all right, it's time to get back in the studio, time to get back in the notebook, time to, you know, this is what my father wanted me to do. So this was the song right here that I felt made sense to start rapping again. Hold up.
Nobody smiling. Smiling.
Send a shout out to my pops, Willie Griffin.
Nobody smiling.
Yo, I'm from the planet Earth. My place to birth, born to be the sole controller of the universe. Besides a part of the map, I hit birth. Any environment I can adapt when it gets worse. The rough gets going, the going gets rough. When I start flowing, the mic bust. The next day to shake from the power I generate. People in Cali used to think it was earthquakes. Cause times is hard on the boulevard. So I broke guard, never get scarred of guard. But it seems like I'm locked in hell. Looking over the edge, but the R never fell. A trip to slip, cause my knife got grip. Stand on my own 2 feet, come equipped. Any stage I'm seen on, a mic I fiend on. I stand alone and need nothing to lean on. Going for self with a long way to go. So much to say, but I still flow slow. I come correct and I won't look back. Cause it ain't where you're from, it's where you're at. We in a... Yeah, we in a... I'm from the... Big up, R.I.P. Check it out.
I learned to relax in my room and escape from New York and return through the wound of the world as a thought. Thinking how hard it was to be born. Me being creamed with no physical form. Me and yourself with one destination to reach the best part, this life's creation. 9 months later, a job well done. Make way, cause here I come. Since I made it this far, can't stop now. It's the will and the way, and I got the know-how to be all I can be and more. And see all there is to see before. Called to go back to the essence. It's a lot to learn, so I study my lessons. I thought the ghetto was the worst that could happen to me. I'm glad I listened when my father was rapping to me. Cause back in the days, they lived in caves. Exiled from the original man and strayed away. Now that's what I call hard times. I'd rather be here to exercise the mind. Then I take the thought round the world twice. Now the wrong back to knowledge precise. Cross the desert that's hot as the Arabian. But they couldn't cave me in, cause I'm the Asian. Reaching for the city of Mecca, visit Medina. Visions of Nefertiti, then I seen her. Mind keeps traveling, I'll be back after. I stop and think about the brothers and sisters in Africa. Return the thoughts through the eye of a needle. For miles I fought and I just bought the people. Under the dark skies, on the dark side. Not only there, but right here is an apartheid. So now is the time for us to react. Take a trip through the mind when you get back. Understand your third eye, seen all of that. It ain't where you're from, it's where you're at. We from the... Yeah. Yeah. Thank you.
Man, I kept hearing this beep here on stage. And I thought, honestly thought it was your cell, and I didn't want to be rude and be like, yo, Rob, can you quiet it? But it's actually all these amazing questions we've been getting.
All right, nice, nice.
So I want to dip into something from the audience. And it relates actually directly to what you just gave us there. A song that has a sense of the world at large, that looks outward at the world with a conscious mind. And this person asked, do you believe that in order to be considered one of the best MCs in history, you actually have to say something in a conscious realm, such as you do, no matter the art of rap? Or can one get by just by form alone?
Good question. And that was the answer. It's a lot of energy in this part of the room right here, man. Well, this is the VIP section, the drinks is... Cause I like the energy from here, man. But exactly, man, I think once you're in that category, I think it's because you're a well-rounded, like complete package MC, man. And I think what resonates with people the most is reality. And I think that's the difference, man. I mean, you know, things sound good. You know, you come out with a nice record, it sound good, but I think the things that stick with us is the things that we can take, you know, with us and you know, hold as our own. You know what I mean? Sometimes, you know, certain things inspire us. It might be something in the record. It might be something that we was going through at the time when the record comes out that just, you know, tells us to keep our head up or keep moving. And it could be just two words. But that's all we need, and you know that's what it takes, man. You know, and yeah, you gotta have the full, you know, complete package.
That leads to.
I think so. Not saying I got the complete package, but I think, you know. Yeah. Yo, exactly. You know what I mean?
Speaking of the complete package, back in '88, Kool Moe Dee, your brother Kool Moe Dee, put out an album where he had something called the Rap Report Card.
Word,
remember that?
Crazy. And, word up.
Yeah, and he rated. You know, all the MCs of the era, just like professors like me are supposed to do, you know, A, B, C, whatever.
That was dope. That was
you got an A. You got an A. Although he gave his ass an A+. He gave himself an A+.
It's only right. I would have probably did the same thing. You know what I mean? But yeah, man, and, you know, to get the cosign from, you know, like that, you know, that I looked up to Mo D, you know what I mean, and to get the cosign from him, man, means a lot. And what's funny, like, I'm the type where, you know, somebody might be like, yo, Rob, man, yo, Mo D got a report. I'm like, oh, shit, here we go. You know what I mean? But he showed a lot of love, man, and, you know, appreciative of that, man. And, you know, we need a little more of that sometimes, that kind of, you know, tells you where you are, what you're doing, and what you're not doing. So, you know, big up to Mo D for that word.
For sure. Yeah. To go back to our questions from the crowd, what are you hearing today that piques your ear? I mean, you talk about really, you know, digging into JB and to Bob James and so forth. Is there anything that you're hearing from young artists now where you say they have something going on?
Ooh. I think something happened over there, man. You gotta go fix that. Well, give us a couple minutes, y'all. We're gonna go over here. man, it's look, you know, I'm still a fan. I'm still a fan though. You know what I mean? I still get inspired by, you know, hip hop today. You know, a lot of it, you know, I say some of it needs a little maturing.
Yeah.
But you gotta accept that, man. You know, hip hop is, you know, a young genre that, you know, moved across the world at a rapid speed.
Yeah.
And people in different cities grabbed it and, you know, did what they felt was, you know, hip hop with it. And like I said, you know, it was young in a lot of places, like in the Bronx when it was young. Hip hop, hip hop, you know, stop, you rock to the bang, bang, boogie. You know what I mean? And when you listen to that today, you'd be like, what the fuck is we talking about then? The bang, bang, boogies. That shit was popping though, you know what I mean? So, you know, that was our young hip hop.
Yeah, yeah.
And then, you know, it advanced to, you know, the 80s and the 90s and, you know. And
it advanced to you. I mean, I gotta say it. You ain't gonna say it, so.
Thank you, man.
Yeah,
thank you.
Yeah.
Hold up.
Yeah.
Up, man. So, you know, I understand that, you know, it had to move around to be the genre that it is today, man, because early 80s, a lot of people thought it was going to play out, you know what I mean? And you know what I mean? I was one of them soldiers too, because, you know, I was involved in it. People used to be like, yo, what you doing in that, man? I thought you was going to be a football player. Then I was like, ah, come on, man. Like, yo, it's going to be good, man. You know what I mean? This is, shit going to get better, man. And, you know what I mean? I was able to make a successful career out of it. You know what I mean? So,
hell yeah.
Hold up.
Hell yeah.
All right.
Well, it.
Still here too, man.
Still spitting.
Wow.
Now, I mean, a lot of your lyrical babies, I'm not going to start any scandals here, but a lot of your lyrical babies are out there in the world, and they're on the
DNA,
mic.
DNA, man. DNA test.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's there, whether it's Kendrick, for instance, who claims you as a inheritor, you know, as an ancestor to his style, or even two weeks ago, speaking of sports, LeBron James was asked what he listened to growing up. He said Eric B. and Rakim.
Wow.
You know?
Wow.
Give shape to the culture.
That's crazy. Well, I missed that.
Yeah.
Somebody catch that and send me that, man.
Yeah.
That's one of the accolades you like to brag about, you know what I mean? Just be like, yo, Rob, man, you've been rocking for a long time. Yeah, yeah, but LeBron just shouted me out last week. Wow. You know I mean? It's still going, man. It's still going, man. 86. Shit. Yeah, man.
Yeah. Hell yeah.
86. Well, hey. What's up, baby?
Yeah, that's love. He does. Well, that's love.
That's love. Big up LeBron. Big up LeBron.
Yeah. Well, and when you made that move to your solo career and were reborn as an MC in some sense, extending what you did with Eric B, but then also kind of taking a little bit different turn, what was your vision for yourself as a solo artist? What were kind of maybe the direction you wanted to take it?
I think at that time, I think my biggest demon was the amount of time that I was off. You know what I mean? A lot of people like, yo, Rob, man, it's going to be hard for you to, you know what I mean? It's been so long since your last album. Man, people been telling me that since 86, man. You know what I mean? In 86, I had to hear, yo, Rod, it's gonna be hard to top that one. You know what I mean? So every album I did, it was always something. And, you know, that one, a couple other ones was, you know, a lengthy time in between. But, you know, to hear that, you know, they don't know. They was just, you know, adding fuel to my fire, man. You know what I mean? I love when somebody tell me I can't do nothing. You know what I mean? I love that. I mean, that's what keep me going, man. So, you know, hearing that, knowing the difference in hip-hop when I was, you know, making albums and the way it was changing rapidly, man, I had to fight not conforming to what was going on. And that was like, you know, the one of the things that, you know, I had to, you know, just let myself know, like, yo, Rob, you know, that's what they do. Hopefully my fans will stick with me. They know what I do. And I just had to try to make, you know, some good rock hip records, man, and not get caught up in the, you know, I'll come in the house and kill everything and, you know, shoot the dog in the backyard. You know what I mean? Chop up the hamster and eat your glass out the cabinets. Like, how hard could one rapper be, man? You know what I mean? So I'm sitting there, I'm like, I could either appear harder or I could just go the other way, man. You know what I mean? But that's what it is, man. Rap was, you know, the gangster era, you know, at its peak at that point, man. So I just try to make sure that I was making good music and not get caught up in, you know, the shit that was going on. Hold on.
Speaking of that gangster moment and another gifted MC, Tupac Shakur, we have probably a half dozen questions about Tupac and just your reflections on him as an artist, what experience you had with him. You did, of course, the key song on the soundtrack to Juice, Tupac's breakout role.
Hold up.
If you could speak on Pac a little bit.
Hey, you know what I mean? That's for my ladies right there, man. But yeah, man, it was dope, man, because I met Pac and the Digital Underground before the first record. I was down in Florida at a concert, and we was going through the back, you know, the entertainer's entrance, and Shock G was standing there with a big poster in his hand, and it was a poster of me. So I said, yo, stop the bus, man, stop the bus. Eric B was mad because he wasn't on it. I said, yo, stop the bus, man. So I got off the bus. Nice big picture, all, you know, colored in. It was a picture, you know, of me laying on like a slab of concrete with MCs under the slab of concrete, just smashed them. Dope. It's still in my studio to this day, you know what I mean? Dope. So I get out the bus, I'm like, yo, you know, what's going on? He's like, yo, peace, Rob, man, we wanted to present this joint to you, we'll want him. Looking at the joint, I'm like, yeah, this is crazy, big boy. I'm like, yo, make sure everybody get passes and everything. So I met him, it was Shock G, Pac, Young Pac, you know what I mean? He just rolled up, and a couple other brothers that was with him, man. And, you know what I mean? Couple, maybe a year later, a little more than that, their first record came out. So I was like, you know what I mean? So, you know, it was dope to, you know them, you know, before the record, to know, you know, they was young brothers in the hood, you know, loving hip hop and striving, you know, at the same time, and to see them come up and make it, it was, you know, just like one of them things when you travel and you happen to meet people and boom, you know what I mean? So big up. But I love Pac, man. Love Pac. He pushed the envelope for MCs, man, and made it okay to be conscious. He made it okay to put messages and it made, you know, make you think outside the box, man. So I love artists like that, it made it easier for me to do what I was doing as well. But I just love artists that, you know, took the chance to say something that, something where, you can get alienated for, saying this, or back then being conscious, you can get alienated for. So it was good to see rappers take that chance to say something, because it built into, a great thing. Hip-hop became so conscious and so crazy in the late 80s and in the 90s. Sure. And it was because of brothers like that. You know what I mean?
Man.
Thank you. Huh? Say that again. Thank you.
He did. And Pac knew that. Pac knew that you laid the foundation both for conscious artistry, but also for the other shit. I mean, the shit where he was rapping not just to half the population, but to women as well, and a conscious sense of how to open up the art form, you know?
That's right.
Man. But,
Thank you.
I feel like we need some more music. You got it in you? You got a little your, one of your solo joints or something?
I think I got a little something in me, man.
All right. Let's do this.
Let's see what we got. Yeah. Okay. Solo shit. Yeah. Primo on the beats. Colorado. Say ho. Say ho, ho. Say hip hop. Say hip hop. Follow procedures. The crowd couldn't wait to see this. Nobody been this long awaited since Jesus. Who wouldn't believe this? I heard the word on the street is I'm still one of the deepest on the mic since Adidas. They said I changed the time with the rhymes that I thought of. So I made some order, put the new world in order with mathematics. Put your status above the average and help your rappers make paragraphs with graphics. Cause new days is dawning, new ways of performing. Brainstorming, I write and watch the night turn the morning on and on it. I got the whole world responding. Rock, keep it hot, blow the spot without warning. The emperor, well known for inventing the sentence, full of adventure, turning up the temperature, rush with adrenaline. How long has it been again to be in the state of mind that Rakim is in? Put your hands in the air one time for your boy. Let me hear you say Rakim. Say Rakim. When I flow tonight, show them new heights, I go to right. They know I strike or do prototypes to blow the mic. Critics and biters, don't know where my source of light is. Still leave authors and writers with arthritis. Curse kids like the pyramids when they found the staff. First to ever let a rhyme flow down to now. The rebirth for hip-hop, be dropped now. Cause the crowd didn't hear the original in the wow. So be alarmed, what you about to see is the bomb. Like 3D and ARM, vivid like CD-ROM. Info kept like internet. My notebooks are born like the Holy Quran. Since I came in the door, said it before. And no, I ain't down with Eric B no more. At night, the open mic be inviting me to rhyme. So, yo, I'm online. It's been a long time. One time for your mom. Yeah.
So I got another question from the crowd. And this one lays into what you just did, which is basically quoting yourself. You know, going to the past, but also moving forward. And this person asks, what would you say to your 1986 self?
Yo, that's a dope.
What advice? What do you got?
I think. What year? '86. What would I say to my '86 self? Y'all got time? So I put myself to the side, man, and then say a whole bunch of shit, man. Like, knowing what I know now. But I think, to sum it up, I think to sum it all up, though, I think I'll tell myself, stay focused. Don't let nobody deter me from what I'm doing. And do what I do from the heart, man. I think, I think that's what, got me this far, man. Like, I always try to speak from the heart, and, what I felt, was real, or what I felt was, heartfelt, whatever that was. But I felt if it was from my heart, then, that'll be the difference, And that's the difference that we all have, man, to the artists out there, if it's rap, if it's music, if it's artistry, if it's dance, whatever it is, the thing that we have that separates us from everybody, even though we all alike, but the thing that we have is that originality. Nobody's going to think like you think. Nobody's going to think like you think. I mean, and that's you know, that was my head start, or that was my advantage on other rappers. I was like, look, they could do what they want, but they ain't think, they ain't doing this right here. And anybody that try to do this, they ain't gonna be able to do this, because this me. You know what I mean? So that's all I can do to keep myself in the game, no matter how long it was before an album came out, or, you know, how long I've been in the game. That was my thing, man. Yo, Rob, just speak from your heart. Do what you do. Think like you think. Round up.
Yes, yeah. After that profundity, I think we need to exhale with a quick question here, which is Jets or Giants?
Giants, man, Giants. Giant fans in our eye, no doubt. Big Giant fan.
Yes, sir. How about Yankees or Mets?
Yankees, man, Yankees.
All right.
Yeah! Yankees, man.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. New York is still in the house, man.
Hold up.
Yeah. So, I've heard a few times, this is not me, this is someone else writing, that you write your rhymes in a book in graffiti so no one else can bite. Is that true?
Yeah. To this day. Yo, back in the day, I think I was in like, might have been in like 9th or 10th grade. I lost a notebook. Traumatizing. For about 2 weeks, I was running up on everybody in the class. Hey, yo, son, I know you seen my book, man. Hey, yo, son. Yo, son, I know you. Yo, Rob, man, I ain't seen. Yo, I mean, I felt like a piece of me was stolen. You know what I mean? Never found it, man. And not only that, I was like this every time a rapper got on the mic. I was like, go ahead, say one word, two words that I said back to back, man. I'm coming for you, man. I never found a book. I never heard nobody biting the rhymes. It was just like Pee Wee Herman when he lost his bite. Word up. I'm dead. Yo, nauseous, just sick, can't think. Everybody having fun, you sitting there. Yo, this, I mean, the worst feeling. And the book was, I had a bunch of shit in that book, man. So after that, I said, you know what? If I lose another book, they won't know what the fuck is in this one here. So I started writing in graffiti, and I even started spelling words different. So, you know, if somebody picked it up, that should look like alien fucking writing. The fuck? You know what I mean? That's what I wanted, just throw that shit in the trash. Yeah, stupid. But, you know what I mean? After that, man, always wrote. And then as I got older, it wasn't so much of me losing a book. It was like somebody coming behind me and opening my book up and reading what I just wrote. I don't care if it's my wife. Just stay out of my notebook. It's almost like you painting something and you ain't finished it yet, you ain't put all the colors in, and then everybody coming in the room. Hold up, man, let me put the last couple colors on, man. And my work look crazy when it's unfinished too, so that was another reason why, you know what I mean? My wife sometimes, she used to read my work, I fall asleep. She like, yo, what the fuck was you writing last night? That's all right, wait you here, it'll be all right, just. You know what I mean? Well, real funny, man, with my writing, man. And sometimes I write from the end of the verse to the top, to the first bar. And when I first started doing that, I was embarrassed because I thought that was cheating and shit. But I don't believe in writer's block. So I get to a certain point, and if my pen wasn't flowing and I had work to do, got to turn in, you know, music by a certain time. If I know what the hook was doing, I know what the 16 bars saying. And then from there, I worked my way back 15th all the way to the first bar. You know what I mean? Then I call them up the next morning. Yeah, come get this shit, man. I'm done. You know what I went through to finish this shit, man. But that's my battle with writer's block. I don't believe in it. So I found ways to, you know, keep it pushing, man. But I love what I do.
Man, I mean, even if people could actually read what you wrote, a lot of them wouldn't be able to understand. A lot of MCs wouldn't be able to understand the multisyllabic words that you were dropping in there. So part of it. And the 5% of knowledge that you were dropping as well.
Yeah, sure.
So could you speak on your faith and how that shaped your art? It's one of the themes that cuts through all of your catalog, your sense of God as God manifests itself in many ways. Can you speak on that?
Yeah, sure. I think that right. What's up, bro? Yes, sir. My man, thank you for that, man. Appreciate it. Hold up. But yeah, man. I think my culture kept me on the path. You know what I mean? It let me know what I could say and couldn't say. It pushed my way of thinking, you know what I mean? It kind of made, you know, provoked me to be more edgy, real, deep, mystical, mystic, you know what I mean? Knowing that and having knowledge of self, it just gave me a wider window to manifest and convey my art, man. But I think that, like I said, I think the main thing, it gave me a sense of righteousness. So I tried to just, you know, make sure I stayed in that path.
Yes, sir.
Peace for the gods and earth.
Your manager, Matt, drop some knowledge about a particular song that I think manifests exactly what you're talking about. And maybe if you could share with the audience a bit about the genesis for Holy Are You.
Holy Are You, yeah. That was a song that, certain songs I like to do to kind of explain the way I think, and I like to compare myself to a lot of prolific things, you know what I mean? And Holy Are You is one of them thought-provoking songs that make you ask the question, who are we? And even deeper than that, you know, who are you? You know what I mean? And, you know, one of them songs that, you know, the album, my album, it's not complete until I put a song like that on it, you know what I mean? So it's just, you know, the song that kind of explains Rakim and I guess my ideology on life and hip-hop. God MC. Uh-oh, I'm feeling the energy shift from over here to up here now.
Come on,
you know what I mean? That's what I'm talking about, man.
Yo, somebody asked, what strain? They just said, what strain? You're in Colorado.
What strain?
What strain you going with?
What strain? Help me out, Denver. What's the best strain out here? A man's face on fire. Whoa. Yeah, man, somebody need to come hang out, take me around, man, show me some things, man.
Yo, fuck a Disney World. We got the real.
Yeah. Last time I came out here, man, I was, you know, Denver's one of the places you like to sightsee now. You know what I mean? You come out, try to hit every spot. Yeah, that's dope. Wow.
Well, you know.
Where's that shit at, man? Gotcha.
Indeed.
Go over there after the show.
Man, we getting rambunctious up in here. But you know what? One of the phrases that you brought into prominence is this one called "Paid in Full."
Yes, sir. Yeah.
What do you think?
Y'all know the words of that? Because I forgot that one. That was back in '86. You know what I mean? Should we exhibit A? Yeah. I'm gonna need everybody in the building, rub your money fingers together. We gonna have some fun on this one right here. Check it out. Let me hear you say make money, money. Say take money, money. Say make money, money. Say take money, money. Say I love it. Say I need it. Say I love it. Say I keep it.
Paid in full.
One more time, Colorado, put your hands in the air, rub your money fingers together like this right here. Before we get started, we're gonna do it like this. Let me hear you say money, come on. Say money, come on. Thinking of a master plan. Cause ain't nothing but sweat inside my hands. So I dig into my pocket, all my money spent. Dig deeper, still coming up with lens. So I start my mission, leave my residence. Thinking how could I get some dead presidents. I need money, I used to be a stick up kid. So I think of all the devious things I did. I used to. But now I learn to earn cause I'm righteous. I feel great, maybe I might just search for 9 to 5. If I strive, then maybe I stay alive. So I walk up the street, whistling this, feeling out of place, cause man, do I miss a pen and a paper, stereo and taper, me and ever being, which is my, but without no money, it's, cause I don't like to dream about, so I dig into the book, shutter, so now test, see if I got pulled, hit the studio,
cause I'm paid for it.
Yeah! Colorado! Yeah!
Ladies and gentlemen,
yeah.
The great MC, the God MC, Rakim.
Thank you, man. Very much, y'all. Appreciate the love. Appreciate it, man. Word up. Big time. Thank you.
For y'all with VIP tickets and books, Rakim will be signing. For the rest of y'all, good night. Thank you all for coming out. It's been an amazing event.
Word up. Appreciate it,
y'all. Hand it for yourselves, please.
Before y'all leave, man, it's only right that I shut it down properly. Do a little something Acapulco. Something y'all might know, y'all might have heard this before, man. We're going to do it a little different. Check it out. Follow me into a solo. Get in the flow. And you could picture like a photo. Music makes mellow, maintains the make. Melodies for MCs, motivates the brace. I'm everlasting, I go on for days and days with rhyme displays that engrave deep as x-rays. I could take a phrase that's rarely heard. Flip it, now it's a daily word. I could get iller than numb, a killing bomb. But no alarm, Rakim will remain calm. Self-esteem make me super superb and supreme. Before a microphone, still I feign. This was a tape. I wasn't supposed to break. I was supposed to wait, but let's motivate. I want to see you keep following and swallowing. Taking, remaking, biting, borrowing. Brother tried, numbers died to get the formula. But I'ma let you sweat. You still ain't warm. You would step away from frozen. Stiff as if you're posing. Dig into my brain as the rhyme gets chosen. So follow me at where you're thinking. You were first. Let's travel at magnificent speeds around the universe. What could you say as the earth gets further and further away? Planets as small as balls of clay. Astray into the Milky Way. Worlds out of sight. Falls to Aka, see not even a satellite. Now stop and turn around and look. As you stand in darkness, your knowledge is took. So keep staring, soon you suddenly see a star. You better follow it, cause it's the awe. This is a lesson if you're guessing and if you're borrowing. Hurry, hurry, step right up. Keep following the leader. Peace and love, man. Peace and love, Colorado. Whoa. Thanks for coming out, man. Thanks for coming out tonight. Most importantly, thanks for your love and support throughout the years, man. Appreciate it, man. And hope y'all enjoyed the night. And if you got that book, man, I hope y'all enjoy that book, y'all. Peace and love. Keep representing your city and keep listening to that real authentic hip hop, man. Appreciate it, y'all. Peace and love.